The dictionary definition of trauma is severe emotional shock and pain caused by an extremely upsetting experience. There's no set way to process trauma, but in Unorthodox we see how two different communities, one in Berlin and another in Brooklyn, cope with the tragedies that have shaped them, and in turn, we learn ways to deal with our trauma. In Brooklyn, trauma forms 19-year-old Esty and her community's identity. The action follows the secretive Satmar community of Hasidic Jews, established by a rabbi who had fled Satumare in present-day Romania during the Holocaust. The Satmar community does not mix with others. In Unorthodox, at the head of the sex-segregated table for Pesach dinner, an annual commemoration of the Jews who escaped slavery in ancient Egypt, Esty's grandfather gives his reasons why. The show celebrates the strong bonds of family and tradition within Esty's community, where religious customs and prayers can take place safely, while deadly attacks on synagogues and other venues frequented by Jews rise across the world. This community defies anti-Semitism by living devoutly. We also see in this scene how Satmar Jews draw on past trauma to make members scared of the big bad outside. The Holocaust caused PTSD in its survivors, and its impact lives on. As Auschwitz survivor, chemist and writer Primo Levi puts it, Auschwitz is outside of us, but it's all around us, in the air. The plague has died away, but the infection still lingers, and it would be foolish to deny it. This generational trauma grows from the roots of Esty's family tree and shapes Esty's personal identity. She is discouraged from exploring passions that contradict the community's values. Her piano lessons are so frowned upon, she must take them in secret. Her teacher, Vivian Dropkin, is derided as a shiksa, a non-Jew. But interestingly, though the show never mentions it, Dropkin is a secular Jew. Despite her faith, her choices are not Jewish enough for Esty's devout community. Many Orthodox Jews believe that the way to undo the trauma of the Holocaust is to repopulate. 2013 research from the Pew Center shows that Orthodox Jews have a birth rate of 4.1, as opposed to the US national average of 1.8. Esty totally believes what she's been taught to believe, later insisting, "We're rebuilding the 6 million lost, Jews killed in the Holocaust."
So I feel for her. Bald wirst du im Jüdischen haben deine eigenen Kinder.
6 million is no small sum. And so, alongside the housework needed to keep her home tidy and her husband, Yankee Shapiro, well-fed in perfectly ironed suits, Esty's job is to have as many children as possible. She is taught that sex will give her husband pleasure, which in turn will give her exactly what she wants, and what she's been told she wants, a baby. The problem with this way of dealing with trauma, as we see it through Esty's eyes, is it creates a domino effect. There's a field of academic study called epigenetics, which deals with the concept of transgenerational trauma, or the idea that trauma can be inherited. Some studies suggest that DNA changes in response to horrifying experiences, and that then passes down generations. Whether through epigenetics or not, in Unorthodox, traumatized parents unintentionally traumatize their children. Esty's grandparents are still, understandably, bereft by the Holocaust, and their son, Mordecai, is mentally unwell. As for Leah, her trauma comes mainly from not quite fitting the mold that's been set for her. Esty is tarred by her parents' pain, and now that she's a bride herself, she finds the rules troublesome.
Mommy, please. The apple falls
nicht weit von Bäumen. When Esty tries to argue the case for her to be pleasured rather than traumatized in bed, using scripture as evidence of God's will for it, she is shot down. This text is for men only, not for women's eyes, due to something known as Kavod Hatzibur, or the dignity of the community. Esty's story shows how socially restrictive responses to trauma often unfairly muzzle women. Esty can't get away with half of what her cousin-in-law Moishi can. Moishi is a thief, a liar, an aggressive lout with no consideration for others. Yet his behaviour seems rooted in self-loathing. His moral decay, his own trauma, is catching up with him. as he realizes he has neither the commitment of one community nor the tools of another. Meanwhile, Yankee, a saint next to Moishi, ends up meting out trauma through his childishly ignorant commitment to maintaining his community by any means available. In Brooklyn, we see how trauma sadly sometimes begets more trauma. As Esty's mum puts it,
"So much damage done in Brooklyn in the name of God. All the rules, all the gossip. No wonder Esty couldn't stand it."
Berlin, meanwhile, has a very different way of dealing with trauma. Unorthodox presents Adolf Hitler's former stronghold as a liberal, diverse idyll, where people, especially the young, can do what they want, when they want, with who they want. Once the epicenter of suffering, Berlin counters its past trauma by celebrating joy and reclaiming some of its character that the Nazis tried to extinguish. This is the city that once saw the golden 20s of the Weimar Republic, when Marlene Dietrich rose to fame, cabaret was popular entertainment, and the Bauhaus art movement was founded. This social liberalism comes across in public displays of affection that the naive and modest Esty is struck by. She's used to a traumatic sex life that only ever happened in private, yet was discussed so publicly. In Berlin, the opposite is true. This is because pleasure, rather than procreation, is the goal in Berlin. Esty begins to realise that the world isn't as black and white as she's been taught.
"Or you could try and rescue Robert's attempt at a salad."
The city's physical spaces are examples of how traumatic sites can be reclaimed. On Esty's first excursion with her new friend, she ventures upon what is, to her community back in Brooklyn, hell.
"When the Berlin Wall was up, East German guards shot anyone who tried to swim across this lake to freedom."
"And now?"
"Now you can swim as far as you like."
It might be the location of trauma, but it's not the source of trauma. Unlike the mikveh that blessed Esty, a secular body of water can't bless or condemn. Only people can.
Of course, some people will never be able to find joy in the same waters Hitler gazed across as he decided to end millions of Jews' lives.
But in this scene, Esty has an opportunity to help begin her new life within its waters. Esty removes her wig in this lake, in a more extreme version of the breakup haircut. While the shorn hair beneath it is an imposition of a sect that sees women's hair as so tempting to men it must be shaved off, it's also an uncanny and unintended reminder of the ways in which Esty's ancestors were dehumanised by the Nazis, their heads shaved in the concentration camps. Without this wig, she can float in the water, free to forget her trauma and all the rules and regulations that led to it. The lake scene proves how expressions of individual freedoms can pay tribute to past generations who were once restricted. By swimming in the waters, Esty and her friends do what many from previous generations could not. Joy is, for them, a far more useful tool of remembrance than guilt.
"Oh, the lake is just a lake."
Esty's new friends prove that trauma comes in many forms. Each carries with them their own difficult histories. Some come from war-torn countries, have lost loved ones, or grew up gay in homophobic countries. The friction between Esty and Yale hinges on how their shared trauma is dealt with so differently.
"My grandparents lost their whole families in the camps."
"So did half of Israel. But we're too busy defending our present to be sentimental about our past."
Both Jewish, Esty and Yale's ancestors may have very well died alongside each other in the death camps, but their responses to this trauma couldn't be more different. Yale used music as an escape from military duty and its inevitable traumas, and with her violin in hand, she expresses herself as she chooses. Esty quickly learns that in Berlin, men and women, secular Jews, Muslims, Christians, and others play music together. The only rules are that they turn up, stay focused, and collaborate. Esty no longer muffles her own screams, but unleashes her pain and trauma using the creativity she's always longed to be able to wield. Using Yale's unfiltered freedom as a template, Esty finally expresses her personal identity. The Berliners of Unorthodox haven't forgotten their trauma or that of the city they live in, but have found ways to deal with it, reclaiming Hitler's land for their own joyful purposes, granting personal freedoms to everyone, especially women, and using creativity as a conduit to exorcise their trauma. That's not to say Brooklyn is totally opposite. Like everything else in the show, from the costumes to the sets, Unorthodox handles trauma sensitively and beautifully. No one is outright good or outright evil, and some people struggle in Berlin in the same way others thrive in Brooklyn. Human trauma is complex and individual, not black and white. In Unorthodox, we see the classic tale of a Jew escaping European trauma and captivity in reverse. In Berlin, Esty discovers that undoing trauma can be as simple as going for a swim, communicating with outsiders, and singing her heart out, all on her own terms and in her own time.